this method, the interference is produced by the division of wave front. This method will use the two coherent sources which are produced due to the refraction of the light. Now, Fresnel biprism. What is Fresnel biprism? Fresnel biprism basically consists of two prisms which are of very small refracting angles and they are joined base to base, as you can see in the figure number C. But in actual practice, it is a single prism. Biprism is formed with an obtuse angle of about 179 degree and the two acute angles of 30 minutes or half degree each. In this way, we produce the Fresnel biprism, and this Fresnel biprism is used in experiments to produce the interference, which is having the lot of applications which we will discuss in this presentation. Now here is the experimental setup for Fresnel biprism. As you can see on the screen that I have used an original source S, which is a monochromatic source of light. When the light falls from this source on the upper face of the biprism, then it appears to come from the source S1, which is a virtual source. And when it falls on the lower phase of the biprism, then it comes to appear from the source S2 due to refraction. So due to this, we have produced the two sources, two virtual sources, which are S1 and S2, and they will behave as the coherent sources. Let small d is the separation between these two coherent sources S1 and S2. From this slit, we have used a screen which is to be placed at a distance capital D from the slit. So capital D is the distance between the slit and the screen. If I divide it in two parts, then let small s or small a be the distance between the slit and the biprism, and small b is the distance between the biprism and the screen. So your capital D will be equals to a plus b. So in this way, the waves from the two sources S1 and S2 will interfere in the region shown by the triangles, and you will obtain the interference pattern on the screen, as you can see here, with the central as a maxima, and you will get the alternate dark and bright fringes on the both sides of the central bright fringe, as you can see. Now we will explain that how we can use the Fresnel biprism experiment in order to find out the wavelength of monochromatic source of light. So for that, we know that in order to find out the conditions for path difference for maxima and minima, we have to consider the path difference between the waves coming from source to the screen. As you can see in the previous picture that the path difference between the waves coming from source S1 and S2 and reaching at any arbitrary point on the screen, say at the upper point, it will be decided by the path difference that we will get a maxima or we will get a minima on the screen. So you know very well that the conditions for path difference are, for maxima it is equals to n lambda, and path difference for minima should be equals to n plus 1 by 2 lambda. So whenever these two conditions will be satisfied, accordingly we will get the dark or bright fringes on the screen. The expression for fringe width, you are already familiar with this expression of fringe width. We have obtained in the Young's double slit experiment, beta is equals to lambda capital D upon small d, where lambda is the wavelength of light used, small d is the distance between the coherent sources, and the capital D is equals to a plus b. Now from this expression, you came to know that if I want to find out the value of lambda, I need to first find out the value of beta, capital D and small d. So here I have shown you the actual experimental arrangement which we use in the laboratories in order to find out the wavelength of the monochromatic source of light. So for the experimental arrangement, we use the four uprights on the optical bench. In the first upright, we used to put the slit, and then in the next upright, we used to have biprism, and the third upright, we place a convex lens, and in the fourth upright, we use a micrometer eyepiece. And having these four uprights, by doing the certain adjustments, we will find out the different values of capital D, small d, and beta. As you can see on the screen that the distance between the slit and the micrometer eyepiece, you can write down it as capital D, and it can be directly noted down from the your optical. We'll discuss about the steps to determine the wavelength of light used. As I have told you right now, in order to get the value of wavelength lambda, we have to find out the value of capital D, small d, and fringe width beta. So very first step is we will note down the position of slit and eyepiece from the optical bench directly, so we will get the value of capital D. In the second step, we will find out the value of beta. For that, we will set the crosswire on any fringe we have obtained on the screen, and we will note down the very first reading from the micrometer slit. Right? Then we move the crosswire of the eyepiece on some other fringe, and we will count the number of fringes crossed in between and note down the second reading on the eyepiece micrometer slit. Then by considering these two readings, we will get the average fringe width. So in this way, we can have the value of beta. Now in order to find out the value of small d, what we have to do, we have to look at this picture. In this case, you can see small d is the distance between S1 and S2. So in order to find out the value of d, we have to do certain things. That in the first case, we will move the convex lens in the position L1 such that we will obtain the images of sources S1 and S2 in the eyepiece. Let it be D1. Let for the position L1 of the lens, we are getting D1 as the images of the sources S1 and S2. D1 is the distance between the images of sources S1 and S2. In this particular situation, let small u is the distance of source and the lens L1, means the distance of object, and small v is the distance between the lens and the eyepiece, means the distance of image. Now you know the formula that the height of image divided by height of object is equals to v by u. So by using this formula, I will write down that D1 divided by D, D1 is the image, D is the object. So D1 by D is equals to V by U. So I will get the equation number 1. In the similar way, in the second position, I will now move the convex lens towards the eyepiece such that I can obtain the images of S1 and S2 in the eyepiece. Let at the position L2 of convex lens, I obtain the images of S1 and S2 in the eyepiece, and let the distance between these two images is D2, which we can find out with the help of the micrometer slit. So in this particular case, U dash is the distance between the source S1 and S2 and your lens L2, right? And V dash is the distance between L2 and your screen, or you can say eyepiece. So u dash is the distance of object and v dash is the distance of image. So by using the same method again, I can write down d2 by d is equals to v dash by u dash. So I have obtained the equation number 2. Now by multiplying these two equations, I will obtain the value of d. D comes out to be equals to square root of d1 into D2. So I have also obtained the value of small d. As we have already obtained the value of beta, small d, and capital D, if we place all these values in the formula of beta, then we can find out the value of lambda. However, there is some another method also by which we can find out the value of small d. This is the alternative method to calculate the value of d. This formula you should do, because in some numerical problems we have to use this formula directly. So we will discuss about the derivation method of this formula. You can see in the figure, let small d is the distance between the two sources S1 and S2, as you already know. Now this we will discuss about the alternate method to calculate the value of small d. Now in order to find out the value of small d by this method, in this method, as you know that d is the distance between S1 and S2. This method can be used only when the refractive index of the material of the prism and the refracting angle of the prism, they are known to us. As you can see in the figure that the refracting angle of the prism alpha is very, very small. So the deviation delta is produced by the prism, and that is equals to delta is equals to mu minus 1 into alpha. So you must be aware about this formula. You must have done this in your lower classes, the angle for deviation. So here alpha is the angle of the prism, so that is why we have used here alpha. The value of alpha is put here in the radians. Now from the figure you can see that from the right angle triangle we can write down delta is equals to d by 2 divided by z1. This z1 I have taken here, the distance between s1 s2 and your biprism. So from here you can write down your small d is equals to 2 delta z1. So you can substitute the value of delta from the equation number 1. So you will get small d is equals to 2 mu minus 1 alpha z1. Here mu is the refractive index, alpha is the refracting angle of the prism, and z1 is the distance between the source and the biprism. If all these values known to us, then we can simply find out the value of d. Here in this case we have taken alpha in radians, but if alpha is measured in degrees, then we have to use the another formula written here. D is equals to 2 mu minus 1, you know, this z or z1 alpha pi by 180. So you can use this formula when alpha is in degrees, or you can use the above formula when the alpha is in radians. So by this method we can easily find out the value of small d, and then by knowing the value of small d, capital D, beta, we can substitute all these values in this formula shown to you, and you can determine the value of wavelength of monochromatic source of light used. So I have already told you that this method is very, very accurate method to find out the value of wavelength. Along with this application, that we can find out the wavelength of light used, we can also use Fresnel biprism for some other applications. As I have shown you that this biprism can be used in order to find out the wavelength of monochromatic source of light, we have already discussed. And the another application, which is an important application, is that we can find out the thickness of the thin sheet of the transparent material. Now we will discuss about this application, that what will happen if we introduce a thin sheet of transparent material. Then we will see, you can see in the picture that if I use the biprism experiment in order to find out the thickness of a thin sheet which is made up of the transparent material, and that transparent material could be glass or it could be mica. So what will happen by doing this? If we insert the thin transparent sheet between the path of any one of the wave which are interfering and producing the pattern on the screen, what it will do? It will simply displace the entire fringe system through a constant distance towards the path of the beam, in the path of which we have introduced the thin sheet, right? हाउएवर द फ्रिंज विड्थ वोंट चेंज इन दिस केस. हम ये नहीं कहेंगे कि फ्रिंज विड्थ चेंज हो गया. ओनली द फ्रिंज सिस्टम विल डिस्प्लेस थ्रू अ कॉन्स्टेंट डिस्टेंस एंड वी विल फाइंड आउट दैट ऑल्सो. राइट, लेट अस कंसीडर दैट स्मॉल म्यू इज द रिफ्रैक्टिव इंडेक्स ऑफ दिस ट्रांसपेरेंट मटीरियल एंड टी इज द थिकनेस ऑफ दिस मटीरियल. वी विल सी दैट हाउ दिस थिन शीट और थिन लैमिना displaces the fringes. Right, if you put the thin sheet in the path of any one of the two interfering beams, the whole entire your fringe system will be displaced, right, as you can see in the picture. Now we will take all the things that if S1 S2 are the coherent sources and you consider a thin sheet having the thickness t is introduced in the path of the light from coming from the source S1, right? So obviously it will displace the entire fringe system in the upward direction. Now for the particular wavelength, the refractive index of the plate is mu. Now let us consider the light from the S1 travel partly in the air and partly in the plate. As you can see that it will travel partly in the air and partly through the plate having the refractive index mu. For the light path from S1P, the distance traveled in air will be S1P minus T, because the total path is S1P, but from S1P we have to subtract the thickness T, because for the thickness T the distance is traveled in the material of the plate and not in the air. Right, so we have to consider this thing here. Now let us consider v0 and v1 with the velocities of light in air and in plate respectively. Then the time taken by the light to travel from S1 to P, so what it will be, you know the formula of time. The formula of time is equals to, that is, distance upon velocity. Now see, the distance traveled in air from S1 to P is S1P minus T, right? S1P minus T. It is the distance traveled in air. So I will write down S1P minus T divided by the V0. V0 is the velocity of light in air. And I have to add also about the T. Now T is the distance, you can see, or the thickness of the plate. So it is the distance traveled by the wave in the plate. So we will write down T by V1. Right, now by taking these two equations, in the second step I have substituted the value here for V1. From the formula you know that refractive index is equals to the velocity of light in air divided by the velocity of light in medium. By using this formula I have put here the value of V1, and by rearranging the complete equation I can write down the time taken by the wave to travel from S1 to P is equals to S1P plus mu minus 1 T divided by V0. So you can see that the extra distance, S1P was the distance directly, but due to the plate the extra distance mu minus 1 into T will have to be traveled by the wave. So we will write down that the effective path in air from S1 to P is S1P plus mu minus 1 into T. That is, the air path S1P is increased by an amount of mu minus 1 into T due to the introduction of the plate. Now we know that for the bright fringe we have to write down this path difference should be equals to n lambda, where n is the number of fringes in the distance x. In order to find out the number of fringes in the distance x, we will use a source of white light. The fringes are colored with the central fringe as white. When we use the white light, we will get the colored fringes and the central fringe will be the white fringe. So we will set the cross wire on the central white fringe and we will note down the reading of the micrometer. Now we will just introduce the plate from one side and we will observe the shift in the central fringe. Then we will set the cross wire on the white fringe, and we will again note down the reading of the micrometer slit. And when we subtract these two readings, we will get the value of shift, which will be equals to x. So in this way we can find out. Now this experiment is very, very important, because this experiment shows that the light travels slowly in the medium of refractive index, which is having refractive index greater than 1, because for air we take refractive index equals to 1. If we use a medium whose refractive index is greater than that of air, or if mu is greater than 1, then light will travel slower, because we have seen that the central fringe shifts towards the site where the transparent sheet is introduced. If the shift is observed in the opposite direction, then we can say that the light would have traveled faster in the medium of refractive index mu greater than 1. But from here we have observed that the light would travel slowly in the medium for which refractive index is greater than that of air. So this was the importance of this Fresnel experiment. So thank you. I hope that you understood the idea behind the Fresnel biprism experiment, and we have discussed the two applications. First is the wavelength of light used, and second one is the thickness of the thing. Dear students, myself Rita, here is the test of the next topic called Fresnel biprism. Again, you have to go through the topic, you have to read it properly, solve the numericals related to this particular topic, and then you will be able to perform the test. Test is comprising of multiple choice, short answer type questions, and also the numericals. So here is the first light about the multiple choice questions. The first question for you is, whose principle or law states that each point on the wavefront may be considered a new wave source? Is it a Snell's law, Huygens principle, Young's law, or Hertz law? You have to choose the correct option out of given four options. The next question is, a thin sheet of refractive index 1.5, that is mu is equals to 1.5 and thickness 1 centimeter, is placed in the path of light. What is the path difference observed? You use the appropriate formula for the fringe shift, and then you will be able to find out the by using the appropriate formula you will be able to find out the answer in this particular question. Now the next question is, what is the nature of source of light in the biprism interference experiment? Whether it is a point source, extended source, narrow slit, or a multiple source, right? Choose the correct option. So the next question is, in the Fresnel biprism experiment, the two coherent sources are obtained by refraction, reflection, internal reflection, or reflection and refraction both. You have to choose again the correct option. Now the next slide is about the short answer type questions. The first question for you is, what are the various methods to find D in Fresnel biprism? In my video I have explained you the two methods by which you can obtain the value of D. You have to write down here both the methods. Okay. Next question is, how do you calculate the wavelength of monochromatic source using Fresnel biprism? You know, this is the application of Fresnel biprism. So you have to write down here the proper topic, that how to find out the lambda. Next question is, derive an expression for displacement of fringes when a thin mica sheet is introduced in the path of one of the interfering beam. This is again the next application of Fresnel biprism, that is the shift in fringes when a thin sheet is introduced in the path of interfering beam. So you have to do all these questions, and you have to write down the answers of all these questions. Next slide is about the numericals. The first numerical is, in a biprism experiment, the fringe width of 1.4 mm with a light of wavelength 6000 angstrom. What will be the fringe width if the light of wavelength 5400 angstrom is used with no other change in the experimental setup? As you know that there is a relationship between the fringe width and the wavelength, okay? Fringe width is directly proportional to wavelength, right? So you use that particular relation and you find out the required answer, okay? The next question is, find the separation between two coherent sources formed by a prism whose inclined faces makes an angle of 2 degree. Here the angle alpha is given to you 2 degree with the base. Now the slit source is placed at a distance of 0.20 meter from the biprism. Okay, and the refractive index given to you is 1.50. You just write down all the data given to you and use the appropriate formula and find out the required answer. Right, so this was all about it. Thank you.